must have time to admire God's creation, a time to praise Allah, and seek His compassion. No doubt you know how short is your life. For Islam's cause you should forever strive. No doubt you know how short is your life. For Islam's cause you should forever strive.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to a new episode of our series on proactivity in Islam with Dr. Haitham Al-Haddad, Director of the Muslim Research and Development Foundation. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sheikh, you were telling us in the previous episodes about stories from Al-Quran where Allah encouraged Muslims to be proactive. You told us about the story of Ibrahim and Ismail alayhim assalam, and you were also in at the end of the last episode going to tell us about the story of the boy, the king, and the magician in Surah Al-Buruj.
Yeah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulillah. This is a very famous story, and the hadith is mentioned in Sahih Muslim, as we said. And I advise the brothers and sisters to read a book written about an author called Rifa'i Surur. Alhamdulillah, the book was written in Arabic. Originally was written in Arabic, and then it was translated. Okay. And by the way, it is available online. Alhamdulillah. Okay. It is the name of that book in English, The Boy and the King.
Okay.
If they search, if they Google it, then they can find it easily. The Boy and the King, and the author is again Rifa'i Surur. Rifa'i Surur. The story goes on, and the boy was learning from the magician. On the way to the magician, the story was hearing the recitation of certain verses by the monk from his church or from his place. So the boy said, let me go and learn. And this is now so many people, they act in a very passive way towards new things. We will see, we will mention one of the stories of the Sahaba. Ali ibn Abi Talib, at one point he was young. In Mecca, this is before they migrated to Medina, one time he saw a stranger. And that stranger was looking for something. So Ali ibn Abi Talib took initiative to know something about the stranger, so he approached the stranger. He was a boy. At that time, he was less than 10 years. Same thing, the story of the boy and the king. The boy didn't say, well, I don't care. He went and he started to listen. And he found that this is something good. So he started to visit the monk to learn from him, the monk or the priest, to learn from him. He was a scholar among the people of the book. So he learned from him Tawheed. Now the boy started to compare between what he was learning from the monk or the priest or the scholar and from the magician. After some time, the boy, the people in that town saw a big animal stopping people from crossing.
Mm.
So the boy, he said, let me see now who is on the right path. Is it the magician or the monk? So this is again, subhanallah, it is an initiative taken by the boy to investigate.
Mm.
And see, you cannot imagine in some riwayat that this boy is around 10.
Subhanallah.
So he took a stone and he said, I will try to kill that animal. So let me say, by the name of the Lord of the magician, and let me say, by the name of the Lord of the monk. The Lord here, it is not, yani the Lord of the magician, it doesn't mean Allah Jalla wa Ala. It means what the magician is telling me about the Lord, who is the king.
Mm.
Because the king at that time, he was telling the people that he is their Lord.
Mm.
Okay?
Mm.
So, he tried by the name of the Lord of the magician, who is the king. It didn't die. Then he took another stone and he said, by the name of the Lord of the monk, of the scholar. And it died.
And that was in front of all the people.
That was in front of all the people. See, this is again a very intelligent movement from the boy. Because now he knew what is the haq. And he gave da'wah to the people in a very clever way. And because of the people, قَالُوا آمَنَّا بِرَبِّ الْغُلَامِ Now we accepted the Rabb of the Ghulam, not the Rabb of the magician or our king. Claimed Rabb, which is the king. And they became mu'mineen because of this. The boy narrated this story to his teacher. The teacher told him, and this is, this story is a very amazing story. And please, brothers and sisters, if you read what Rifa'i Surur wrote about it, you will be astonished, you will be amazed, subhanAllah. The boy told his teacher, and he told him that this and this happened. Look at the teacher and the reaction of the teacher. The teacher told his student, who was a young boy, he said, Ya Bunay, O my son, you became better than me. Now tell me in the world, will any teacher now tell one of his students, now you are better than me?
It's rare.
It is very rare. Very rare. So, and he said to him, and you will be tested. If you were to be tested, don't guide them to me. Okay? And then the story goes on. We don't want to continue mentioning the story. Otherwise, we will just, okay, maybe mention but some other
beautiful story and beautiful lessons deducted from it, definitely and certainly. More lessons from it. So where do you want to go now, Sheikh Haitham? Still with examples from Al-Quran, or do you want examples from...
Let us take, because of time, and we are in the sixth episode. Is that right?
That's correct.
Yeah, so...
You want to take examples from the
from
Prophet,
the Sunnah. Let us take examples from the life of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as I said, I will choose maybe rare examples. And I will choose examples are not related to da'wah, because many people think that when we talk about proactivity, we are talking about proactivity in da'wah or talking about proactivity in what we understand as act of worship, acts of worship. See, ibadah is a comprehensive term. It covers everything in our life.
Right.
Let me give you this story. Anas ibn Malik, he was one of the servants of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Anas ibn Malik, he served the Prophet when he was young. Umm Salaim, his mother, she sent him to serve the Prophet ﷺ when he was very young. One time, he said, he was describing the Prophet ﷺ. He said, كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَشْجَعُ النَّاسِ وَأَجْوَدُ النَّاسِ وَأَحْسَنُ النَّاسِ or أَحْسَنُ النَّاسِ وَأَجْوَدُ النَّاسِ وَأَشْجَعُ النَّاسِ. Ibn Hajar, in the explanation of this hadith, he said that Anas ibn Malik, he was so profound, and he mentioned in those three characters, the characters that encompass all types of noble characters.
The best, the most courageous,
the best,
the most generous.
The most courageous and the most generous. Okay? The best we know, the most generous we know, and the most courageous. Then he went, after most courageous, he said, وَلَقَدْ فَزِعَ أَهْلُ الْمَدِينَةِ I'll mention the story in English. Yes. It's better just to cut the time short. He said, the people of Medina, they heard a very loud noise from one side. And they were scared of that noise. So, they left in order to see what is happening. Yeah, imagine people in the city and they found boom. They heard something like this. So they left in order to see. فَإِذَا بِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ And they saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam coming from that direction, from the direction of the noise. And he was on a horse without the saddle. You know, the saddle means the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam
immediately jumped
yeah. on the horse.
He felt the urgency. There's no time even to
exactly.
put the
saddle. Okay? And he said, don't worry, لن تراعوا لن تراعوا. The point here.
He was the first to go.
He is the Prophet. He could have waited for some time No, either order someone or wait for some time until Jibreel alayhi salam comes to him to explain to him what is happening. No. And this is not a matter related to deen or to related to revelation or related to maybe one of the Sahaba had a problem. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam jumped quickly into the horse and he went, took initiative to know what is happening. Subhanallah al-Azim. This is a very typical example. If we, of course, if we want to mention the so many examples of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I think we'll take so many episodes. But I just picked this example to show that initiative can be in anything. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "At-tu'adatu fi kulli shay illa fi 'amal al-akhirah." Tu'ada means being calm, slowly doing things. Tu'ada. Slowly doing things, except what? In amal related to the akhirah. In things related to akhirah, then you have to be so quick and you need to do them so quickly. This is an example of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. If we study the seerah of the Sahaba radiyallahu ta'ala anhum.
We have just a minute and a half before the break.
A minute and a half, we cannot... the story of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man yujahizu jayish al-usra." Who is going to provide for the army of al-usra? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq jumped into it. Umar ibn al-Khattab jumped into it. But because they were not rich, they went and they found Uthman radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, took care of all
everything.
So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so pleased by Uthman, just by man yujahizu jayish al-usra. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is asking, who is going to provide for that army? Equip that army with everything, and Uthman took that, and that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "La yadur Uthman ma fa'ala ba'd al-an." Nothing will harm Uthman after this point, because he did this. This is another example from the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the life of his companions.
Sheikh Haitham, dear viewers, we'll be taking our break here in this episode. When we come back, more examples from the Prophet's sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's life and his companions, may Allah please with them's life, about proactivity in Islam, with Dr. Haitham Al-Haddad, Director of the Muslim Research and Development Center, a UK-based organization which aims at developing leaders for the Muslim community in the West. Stay with us.
You must have time to admire God's creation.
The spirit of Hajj. Join Sheikh Ma'in Kusa as he speaks about the true essence of Hajj, its meaning, and the wisdom behind its rituals.
Hajj, brothers and sisters, has great virtues which have been narrated to us by our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whoever performs Hajj for the sake of Allah and therein utters no evil, nor commits any evil act, would return from his Hajj as the day his mother gives birth to him. That is, he would return pure from sins, as if he was just born. Eid is even a larger gathering of Muslims in the same town.
All of these and more in the spirit of Hajj.
Huda, a light in every home.
You must have time I am God's creation.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh once more. Sheikh Haitham, you were telling us about examples from the Prophet's life and from his companion's life about proactivity in Islam.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. There are so many examples. One time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was with his companions in a ghazwa, in an expedition. And then he saw a person looking left and right. This is Hadith Jabir in Sahih Muslim as well. Looking left and right. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam immediately understood that this person is looking for something and he does not find enough sustenance. The Prophet ﷺ immediately he said, "Man kana ma'ahu fadlun min zadin, faliyaud bihi ala man zada lah. Man kana ma'ahu fadlun min zahrin, faliyaud bihi ala man la fadla lahu." Whoever has excess of food, he should give it to those who do not find enough food. Those who have more space, you can say, in their camels or in their mounts, then they should give help and they should give rides for those who do not have. Rights. That was immediate reaction. And that was not related to Salah and Siyam, as many people think, that the Prophet ﷺ was only taking care of these things. And here in this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that person, some scholars say that he did not find a mount or a camel to ride, to use in the expedition. The Prophet ﷺ did not say, if a person has more camels or has a space on his ride, he can give those who do not find, because this might give an implication, this might give an impression that I'm talking about this particular person, and this might embarrass him. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started with what? Azad, food. Those who have more food. Okay, they can give those who do not find enough food. So now the people will think who is not right. finding enough food.
Right.
And they will not think about this particular person.
Yes.
See, the Prophet ﷺ was so gentle in order not to embarrass this person. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever find a space or can help those who do not find enough mounts or rides, he should help them. This is another example of the proactivity of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one time, he saw Ibn Umar, and he put his hand on Ibn Umar, and he said, "Kun fi dunya ka annaka gharibun aw amiru sabil." Just he's taking initiative to teach Ibn Umar, and Ibn Umar at that time, he was young. Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, in one riwayah, the Prophet ﷺ migrated to Medina when Ibn Abbas, the great companion, he was less than, 10 years. Look at this. How many times Ibn Abbas said that I was riding behind the Prophet ﷺ in a camel, and he told me, "Ya ghulam, inni u'allimuka kalimatin fahfadhun, ihfadh Allah yahfadh." Be mindful to Allah Jalla wa Ala. Allah Jalla wa Ala will protect you. That was Ibn Abbas. And we see so many examples that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was taking initiative to teach the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One time, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam missed a lady that he used to clean the masjid, an old lady. تقوم المسجد امرأة سوداء كانت تقوم المسجد in the hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Where is that lady? Where is that lady? He took care of her." And that is, again, is not directly related to maybe Salah or Siyam.
SubhanAllah. And there is that story when the Prophet asked about his neighbor that used to hurt him because he didn't find...
We will come to this story.
Yeah,
we will come to this story. This is a very... I don't know whether you mean that story or not.
I think it's...
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina, he had a neighbor.
Right.
A Jew.
Right.
And the son of that Jew, he used to serve the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sometimes. And that he became sick. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in one of the hadith, said, "Law amana bi," in Sahih al-Bukhari, لو آمن بي عشرة من اليهود لآمنت يهود. If 10 people from the Jews accepted my da'wah, then all of the Jews will accept Islam. However, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam does not leave any chance without making the maximum of it to convey the message of Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he went to visit that boy. He said that maybe that boy, or for sure that boy, is sick. So he took the initiative and he visited that boy. And then the boy was sick and about to die on the deathbed. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Aslim. Accept Islam. Directly. The boy looked at his father. Subhanallah. Allah Jalla wa Ala mentioned about the Jews that they يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاهُمْ. They know the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as they know their children. So the boy looked at his father. His father looked at him, looked at the Prophet. He said, أطيع أبا القاسم.
SubhanAllah.
Listen to the commandments of Abul Qasim. Listen to him. Do what he commanded you to do. SubhanAllah. The boy said, La ilaha illallah. He died after that. Immediately he died after La ilaha illallah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so happy. And he left and he said, Alhamdulillah, alladhi anqadahu bi min al-nar. Alhamdulillah. Thank to Allah that he saved this person from the hellfire. لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُّمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. One of the main characteristics of the Prophet ﷺ is what? To have mercy. فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاقِعٌ نَفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمْ إِنْ لَمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَسَفًا. Are you going to harm yourself because they don't accept the message of this Qur'an? So the Prophet ﷺ was so merciful and he doesn't want this boy to go to the hellfire. So he took the initiative and he visited that boy, he visited his father in order to pass the message of Al-Islam. And here, there is a very important lesson. When we give people da'wah, we are not, please brothers and sisters, I know maybe this is a little bit out of the topic, but it is related to what we are talking about. When we give people da'wah, we don't give people da'wah to benefit us. We don't give people da'wah so they will aid Islam and Muslims. That is a minor aim. The main aim is what? To protect them and to save them from the hellfire. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, as we said in the very beginning, أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ أَنْقِذُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ مِنَ النَّارِ. Protect yourselves from the hellfire. The boy, the Prophet ﷺ was not so pleased just because now the number of Muslims increased by one. He died already. But the main thing, the Prophet ﷺ was so pleased and so happy because that boy is now going to go to Jannah. And that's why when we have any chance, brothers and sisters, to call people to Islam, to save people from hellfire, then we should do so. Brothers and sisters, we see so many situations in front of us. And in many cases we say, no, he will not accept Islam. Or if I tell him about Islam, now we have 1 minute, 2 minutes, maybe it is not enough to convey Islam to him. No, ya akhi, do it. Do it. Because at the day of resurrection, you will come in front of Allah Jalla wa Ala and you will say to Allah Jalla wa Ala, oh Allah, I did my job. I have done something. This is from one side. From the other side, you don't know. This person might accept Islam. And if that person accepted Islam, all the deeds, look at this, brothers and sisters. When a person accepts Islam because of you, all the deeds that this person is doing, you will get a similar reward. When this person starts, imagine a boy accepted Islam because of you. And he died on the age of 80. Yeah? How many salah he's doing? In every 1 year, he is doing thousands of salawat. All these thousands of salawat, on a yearly basis, you will get a reward. When he fasts the month of Ramadan, you will get a reward. When he goes to Hajj, he will go to a reward. Wallahu yudha'ifu liman yasha. If this person becomes a da'iyah himself, and he's calling people to Islam, you will get a reward because of this. And when people followed Islam because of him, those people, when they do good deeds, you will get rewards because of this. So why to sit passive? In particular, things related to da'wah ila Allah jalla wa ala. And there are amazing examples of the da'wah to Allah jalla wa ala in our time and in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Ali ibn Abi Talib, لَأَنْ يَهْدِيَ اللَّهُ بِكَ رَجُلًا وَاحِدًا خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْ حُمُرِ النَّعَمِ. To guide one person, or Allah Jalla wa'ala to guide one person through you, is better than the red camels. Red camels means the prestigious or luxurious cars at our time. I noticed that you are telling me that the time.
Yeah, we have less than a minute here, and I think Sheikh, that at least if you're not going to make da'wah, then you have to be a good role model. I mean, that would be the least anybody could do, wouldn't it?
That is the least. But I don't want to mention this point, because some people will act in a very passive way. And they say, oh, I am a role model for others.
Right.
And
they can just imitate me.
Yes.
They know. Yeah. But the point is, there are so few role models even nowadays.
It's true.
So it's,
and that's why I'm going to mention in the other story, inshallah, maybe in the next episode, an amazing story of a sinner.
Okay.
An amazing story of a sinner and how he affected the da'wah and how he affected Islam. Inshallah.
Okay, looking forward to that. Sheikh Haitham Al-Haddad, Director of the Muslim Research and Development Foundation, will be looking forward to the upcoming episodes on this very beautiful topic, proactivity in Islam, how to serve our religion, how to serve our lives. Dear viewers, do join us again. Until we meet again, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
You must have time. Admire God's creation, a time to praise Allah, and seek His compassion. No doubt you know how short is your life, for Islam's cause you should forever strive. No doubt you know how short is your life, for Islam's cause you should forever strive. You must have time to admire God's creation, a time to praise Allah.